If necessary, I would be the designated safety officer. The doors for the exit are behind you, and you can go down that staircase. And we have an assembly point at National Geographic, which is on M Street, should that become necessary for any region. This is the 22nd of the U.S.-Japan Security Seminar Series, started with JIIA, Japan Institute for International Affairs, and CSIS Pacific Forum. For many years, these were held in San Francisco, and led ably by Jim Kelly and then Ralph Casa. Past few years, we've done it here. And we look forward to this opportunity to have a stock taking of the U.S.-Japan Alliance, and as an opportunity for people out of government, people who've been in government, people who will never be in government, people in government, to compare notes, think of ideas. And historically, this seminar has produced some important concepts and turning points in the Alliance. I was a beardless graduate student when I attended what I think was the first or second of these seminars in San Francisco. And the debate in 1994 or so was mostly about Okinawa. What's the Alliance for after the Cold War? And then I remember 95, 96, all of a sudden the Pacific Forum hosted San Francisco Conference was a place where what became known as the Nye Initiative really congealed and got buy-in across the Pacific and across party lines and among experts and was really articulated. And then again in 2000 in San Francisco, there was a bit of drift in the relationship. There was a lot of fighting over host nation support and mechanical issues, but the strategy had been lost. So people began talking about the need for a strategic dialogue to reboot the Alliance. And I personally went into the administration in 2001 with Rich Armitage and others, and one of the first things we did based on that discussion was establish a strategic dialogue with Japan, which continues. So this has been a great opportunity to, as I said, take stock and start to really think about the next phases of our security relationship, reflecting the domestic politics and the security environment. And today we're going to take a particular focus on the maritime challenges in the Western Pacific, where the U.S. and Japan have largely overlapping, if not identical, interests, complementary tools, a strategy, and the strategy is not really working in many ways. So it's a perfect time to take a look at those issues. We have a panel I'll introduce shortly who will guide us through this, and then we'll open it up for questions and comments from this very senior and expert audience. But first I want to ask Ambassador Nogami, President of JIIA, to make some opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Mike. As Mike mentioned, this is the 22nd meeting of the U.S.-Japan Security Alliance. This meeting started as a sort of small collegial meeting amongst the so-called, what we may call, alliance managers. But there was a growing need for a public outreach program like this one, this time. So we moved the venue with the kind understanding on the part of Pacific Forum, CSIS, and with the good assistance from CSIS Washington. So this public meeting is one of the reasons why we moved from San Francisco to Washington. And we wanted to share what what we discuss amongst the so-called alliance managers. We are now faced with a very serious situation in that part of Asia Pacific, in our part of the Asia Pacific, particularly on the issue of maritime security. This issue is not only threatened the actual security situation, but also issue poses a more fundamental question about who is going to be responsible for for maintaining the post World War liberal democratic order, rule-based order. So I think this is the most appropriate, opportune subject for this public session to deal with. Now, I would like to, again, once again, ask Mike to kick off the meeting. Thank you very much.
We're going to move the mic for a minute so that we can include the half of the audience over there that we can't see right now. Ah, what a group of alliance faces. So our focus today, as I said, is going to be on the challenges we face in the Western Pacific, in the East China Sea, the South China Sea, the first island chain and second island chain. As maritime nations, and the U.S. and Japan are undeniably maritime nations, when Commodore Perry came back from Japan, he gave a series of speeches in New York and elsewhere explaining why there would be an enduring relationship between the U.S. and Japan because we had a similar outlook as maritime nations and modernizing nations. We have a common interest in freedom of navigation, secure sea lines of communication, and ensuring that the Pacific is open and secure, and that there are no unilateral efforts to change the status quo, rewrite the rules, and that what is happening right now in the East and South China Sea touches on essentially all of these issues. We have two admirals up here. It's a maritime and it's a naval problem, but it's, as I think you'll hear from some of our speakers, it's a broader geopolitical issue that's going to involve Japan and the U.S. and other like-minded states like Australia, or perhaps India and Korea and others, addressing this problem using the full toolkit, naval and military, but also diplomatic, rule of law, and so forth. The intention, of course, as a number of us put it in a series of recent reports at CSIS, it's a lot of reading, but I commend them to you. We did an external review of the administration's rebalance to Asia for the Congress, which was commissioned under the 2015 National Defense Authorization Act, which is up on site. We've just published a joint effort we did with the Sasakawa Foundation, with Rich Armitage and John Hamrichuring, with Ryozo Kato and other colleagues, that looks at the alliance over the next 25 years. And we're currently at CSIS undertaking a series of case studies on maritime coercion challenges that we've experienced in the last 10 years and what the pattern is. So we're doing a lot of work on it. But the problem seems to be getting harder even as we begin to figure it out and cooperate more. So with that as preview, we have three speakers who will open up with their observations. I'm going to turn first to Professor Shin Kawashima from the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences at the University of Tokyo to frame for us from his perspective what the Chinese strategy seems to be, and what the Chinese bottom line seems to be, and how we are able to affect that or not. Then I'll ask Admiral Gary Roughead, former Chief of Naval Operations, to speak, and I think he's going to look at this from the U.S. perspective, of course, but from the broad geopolitical dimension and where the maritime strategy fits in. And finally, Admiral Umio Otsuka, the president of the Japan Maritime Self-Defense Force Command and Staff College, you won't believe it looking at us, but a former student of mine, and one of the new Mahans of Japan's MSDF, the man of the sea, Umio Otsuka. And he'll look at specific questions of deterrence, dissuasion, and how we align our efforts to try to stabilize the situation. And emphasizing before I turn to the panelists something I think we all agree on, which is the purpose of our alliance and the purpose of our strategy is not to contain China. And the purpose of our alliance is not to prepare for conflict. Any alliance does that. That's not the purpose of the alliance. The purpose is to set the stage for a more beneficial, stable, predictable relationship. I'll turn it over by saying I think that's going to be hard for a couple of years, but it's not impossible. So we need to get this right while the relationship is scratchy and see if we can set the stage so that we create the environment for a more beneficial partnership and cooperative relationship with the big powers in the region. So with that, let's focus in on China a bit, and I'll turn it over to Kawashima-sensei.
Thank you so much. I have just arrived in DC, and on the airplane, I received one email to change the topic, let's change the time of the presentation, yes. Anyway, Mac, tell me to explain the Chinese intention on its policy towards the South China Sea. So I'd like to explain the intention and the background of its policy towards the South China Sea. But first of all, I'd like to propose the Chinese historical mission to recover its lost territory on its narrative. Yes, this narrative is cannot shared by the Vietnam and the Philippines and other countries. However, China has strong narrative, yes, that China had lost so many territories. So China has to recover the territories, yes, after the Opium War. So Senkaku, Diaoyu Islands, and also other islands in the South China Sea were explained on this context. So in China, Chinese government on the education something explained that all of islands in South China Sea and Senkaku and Diaoyu were originally Chinese territory from ancient era, however occupied by other country illegally. This is the first. However, before 2008, China did not recover it strongly because China changed its policy in 2009 or 10. Okay. Because maybe Chinese recognition perception of the world was changed after Lehman shock in the USA. China's purpose on its foreign policy was changed. Originally, the main purpose of foreign policy was just set on economic development. However, in 2006, 2007, 2008, China changed the purpose of the foreign policy. China added sovereignty and security. So as you know, in 2002, China can compromise about the sovereignty issues at South China Sea with ASEAN countries. However, after 2009 or 10, China did not compromise on the territorial issue on South China Sea. Yes, this is the second point. The third point is the domestic policy. As I said, China explained and again to the nationals, peoples in China, all the islands at South China Sea and Senkaku Diaoyu were Chinese territory originally or from the ancient era. And also China is a strong country and China is a powerful country now. So Chinese people expect Chinese government to recover it. Yes, so and also sometimes China utilizes nationalism to make some mobilization. So that such a policy is useful for Chinese government to get legitimacy in domestic context. This is the point. The fourth point is that actually the Mao Zedong era, Mao Zedong period, the main industries of China was just set at the inner China, Wuhan, Sichuan, and others. However, in these 20 years, after the reform policy of Deng Xiaoping, the most of important industries and population were in the coastal area of China, Shanghai, Guangzhou, and others. So from the security point of view, China has to defend, protect such an important area, region of coastal China. So China wants to manage and control the South China Sea and East China Sea to protect them. This is first. And others, as explore such a 4 points, sea rain and other resources in China Sea is also, are also important for China. Yes, this is my answer to Mike's question. So I'd like to introduce the my present some new topics in 2016 about South China Sea or other problems. Yes, the first point is that the perception is the, I think it's an important point. As you know, in 2015, USA made the operation of free navigation and sent a Navy fleet or B-52 to the Southern Sea. And simultaneously, USA provided some opportunities to make a joint exercise with China. And Japan also supports some ASEAN countries to enhance its capability of coastal guard and maritime security. However, China did not stop building airports and some military facilities on the islands of the China Sea. After the operation of free navigation, China expanded some military facilities at the Mischief, and also set some missile facilities at the Sea Sharp Islands at the western part of the South China Sea. They did not stop. So how does China evaluate and how does China perceive US policy? Actually, I think China does not share, or does not share the intention of USA. The second point, ASEAN. ASEAN countries, except for Philippines, Vietnam, Malaysia, and Brunei, that have the territory issues with PRC China, have more negative attitude to, or the, some sensitive attitude to China maritime policy in South China Sea. It's a new change. Like Indonesia is so sensitive at Natuna Islands with China. This is a new situation. Singapore also. 5 years ago, Singapore is so modest to the so-called China expansion. However, in this couple of years, Singapore attitude, Singapore observation of Chinese expansion, Chinese policy of South China Sea, getting more sensitive and something negative. And the third point is the UNCLOS. It's so important. Philippine application for UNCLOS is expected to change the situation. However, yes, maybe Minister of Wang Yi made a presentation, maybe here. Yes, he also mentioned that China has not accepted and China said the application of Philippine was illegal. China cannot accept it. Yes, this is Chinese attitude. So it's so sensitive in this 1916. I don't know, it is so difficult for us to prospect of the UNCLOS is a one focus. Finally, I'd like to propose one point, is Taiwan. Taiwan comes to be a sensitive actor on this issue in 2015. The president of Ma Ying-jeou visited to Taiping Island at the Spratly Islands was welcomed by PRC. From the PRC point of view, Ma's visit indicates the all of Chinese people protects Chinese territory, okay, by the PRC and ROC. So now that PRC is now so sensitive to attitude of DPP, Min Jindan's new leader, Tsai Ing-wen, to this issue. Yes, we welcome Tsai Ing-wen to cooperate with the US-Japan alliance as others. However, China paid so strong attention to Tsai's policy. So, yes, I think it is welcome. We have to welcome Tsai's joining some operation. However, we have to check the PLC's attitude and TLC's observation of the Tsai's policy. And actually, I prepared so many slides. However, like I said, the decree the presentation time to the 5 or 7 minutes, so I finished my presentation. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Mike, and thanks to CSIS for the opportunity to share some thoughts with you. And I'd like to also take this opportunity to acknowledge the great work that CSIS has done in broadening and increasing the awareness of the things that are going on in maritime Asia. I think that at least in the U.S., and I tend not to spend a lot of time in Washington, But as I go out, if you look at where the attention of our public is, it really is on the Middle East and increasingly on Russia. And the idea of the greater strategic challenge that we face in Asia is really not on the scope. So we tend here in the United States, I think, to focus in on what I call close-in snapshots of things that are taking place. And even in maritime Asia, whether it's the South China Sea or the East China Sea. And I think it's really important that we kind of step back, open the aperture, and look at the global movie that's playing in front of us. And when you do that, by definition, you are stepping away from the Asia-Pacific region. And I believe having to focus more clearly on the Indo-Pacific region, because it is there that the trade flows will be generating, the energy interests, particularly for Asia, will not diminish for decades. And so those are things that we have to pay attention to. And the relationships that are developing in Central Asia, the Middle East, and the Far East all tie into the perspectives. And then you can't discount the challenges that are arising in the Middle East and how they'll find their way into the economic interests and the public interests of countries in Asia. And so I think it really is important for the long view and for the broader picture that we step back and look at how all these play in this broader movie that I've talked about. And especially on the maritime side, because there's no question that in the last couple of years, the maritime dimension of where China is going has changed significantly. And I think in the past year or so, the unequivocal statements that have come out in their strategic documents, the role of the maritime forces, the role of the PLA Navy, are all going to be part of this movie that's going to be playing out. And I think having watched China and particularly the PLA Navy for a couple of decades, as many of you have, the evolution that has taken place is really quite extraordinary. But it's also important to recognize the integration of the maritime forces, both the PLA Navy and their coast guards and other forces that, quite frankly, China has done a very good job of integrating, streamlining, and connecting them in ways that give them significant operational and strategic flexibility that even 5 to 10 years ago did not exist. And we can talk a little bit more about other countries and maritime forces and how well or how well they are not integrated together. And I think it's also important that we look at the temporal, the time period here. You know, I talk about the movie that's playing, and the one that I think we're watching in Maritime Asia is going to play for at least until 2022, which is the end of Xi Jinping's time in office, because my view is that he's the director, he's the producer, and he's the lead actor. And this is not going to change. And the integration of their economic and their security strategies, one with a significant maritime component, the Maritime Silk Road, the other the Silk Road Economic Belt, play into this broader Indo-Pacific region. And so that's what we have to pay attention to and what we have to look at. Clearly, the East China Sea, South China Sea, in my view, they are separate geographically, but they are commingled strategically and operationally. And right now, at least in the United States, the attention is on the South China Sea. A couple of years ago, it was all on the East China Sea. And I think we'll see this play back and forth. My concern has always been more for the East China Sea, because that's where you have two significant military capabilities that have the potential to come into contact with one another. When you get down into the South, there's a little bit more of an imbalance. And so I think it's important that we look at those two areas. What are the challenges? What are the opportunities? What are the types of capabilities that we need to work closely on, excuse me, closely on together as we go forward? There's no question that those areas, the encounters will be more with the other maritime forces, and the PLA Navy will find itself more into the Indian Ocean, North Arabian Sea, and indeed into the Eastern Mediterranean. So I think that we have to look at how those forces will be used. The addition of a logistics base in Djibouti for China is something that will be used significantly as they continue to operate in Africa, whether it's counter-piracy, UN peacekeeping missions, whatever. But that logistics hub is going to be very important. It's a strategic place. It's a strategic sea lane on which it sits. And, you know, it's not just the Chinese that have seen that. We've been in Djibouti for a long time. There's a reason why we're all in Djibouti. Very important economically and strategically. I think the other thing that will be playing out in the coming years is we're going to see a change in the naval postures in the Middle East. The lifting of sanctions on Iran is going to change the Iranian Navy. We in the United States have really had to focus on the Revolutionary Guard forces in the Gulf, but now there will be money, there will be a market, and we will begin to see China and Russia and European defense industries want to seek that market out, and I think we'll see a recapitalization of the Iranian Navy. What does that do with regard to the sea lanes, not just the Straits of Hormuz and the Gulf, but the Red Sea and the contentious areas around the Arabian Peninsula? And it will be complicated by the economic relationships that many countries will now develop with Iran, now that the sanctions are lifted. And so you'll have increasing economic ties, but there are going to be some significant security challenges in the Middle East that we will have to think our way through, because quite frankly, I think we'll have different economic views and we'll have different security views as we go forward. And the other thing I think that's going to be hugely important in the region, as I've said, the submarine has found Asia. We're going to see the underwater domain of Asia, the Indo-Pacific region, change markedly. And what does that mean? And where should we be looking to cooperate and do things together? And as we all know, two countries now have put a strategic nuclear deterrent to sea, China and India, which only complicates and heightens an awareness of how do we deal with the underwater domain. So those are just a couple of areas that thought I'd prime the pump with, Mike.
Excellent, thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mike, and the CSIS, and also the Ambassador Nogami. Thank you very much, and JIA for hosting this conference. Well, I would like to reframe the question of Mike, what are we required to do as status quo power to prevent any revisionist further aggression? It looks like a kind of oral exam during my time at CSIS by the Professor Mike Green. But anyway, in summary, my answer is to continue to strengthen deterrence. At the same time, I would also stress the importance of engagement in order to support the deterrence effectively workable, as well as to mitigate the risk which inevitably comes along with. Well, as for the deterrent, credible deterrence piece, as long as a rising power believes we are gaining supremacy, they would not wage war. That's a theory. So, and China is a pragmatic sovereign country. So what we have to bear in mind is then how we convey the message. Given the development of the technology, like what we see in cyberspace, the demarcation between the military and non-military is diluting, if not disappearing. In addition, there has been emerging a new way of pursuing national interests by mobilizing non-military power into the military arena and concomitantly making again demarcation between the military means and the non-military ones vague. So-called the hybrid warfare is a good example. Using non-military governmental assets in front of the military forces or even militia at the front line are what we have already been faced with in both South China Sea and East China Sea, and the combination with invisible invasion maximizing the cyberspace will bring us in a very tough situation. And we have to be prepared to respond to these types of long-lasting so-called the gray zone challenges, which require to us an attentive and cautious vigilance. In that sense, enhanced bilateral and multilateral ISR in all domains must be the key for the successful deterrence. As we have been accustomed to the traditional way of military business, this new type of challenge may invite misunderstanding and, in due course, miscalculation, which could negatively affect to the credible deterrence. So the next step we need to take is to build a mechanism of communications which allows us to engage for the purpose of conveying the right message at the right timing in order to avoid the miscalculation. I'll stop here for the further discussion.
Thank you. Let me, we'll do a round or two up here and then I'll open it up to the audience. I want to touch on the naval and military strategy dimensions and then the broader geopolitical problem, including diplomacy and trade and regional institutional architecture and so forth. But I want to defy Admiral Roughead's orders and focus in a little bit on some of the specific military questions. Should we, and I'll start with you, Admiral, but I'd like to hear the other two panelists, should we be worried about a Chinese base in Djibouti? It's significant, but should we be worried? And specifically in terms of the so-called string of pearls. So the Indo-Pacific is an important geopolitical concept. Does that mean we therefore have to worry about Chinese presence in Gwadar and up until the election Sri Lanka and so forth leading up to Djibouti? Is this a kind of a new dimension of our security challenges with China that we need to address with military means? Or I want to tease you out a little bit on the Indo-Pacific and whether this is now a threat to us, an opportunity. How do you see it?
I tend to not talk in terms of being worried or in terms of threats. I think that what we have to deal with and what we really have to think through as China now will be able to support increased presence in the North Arabian Sea, Red Sea, Somali Basin, I think that what we have to do is have a very realistic view of what the force structure requirements are going to be going forward. We really become enamored and intoxicated with capability. And when you look at the Pacific and the Indian Ocean, capacity is going to be hugely important. And what China has now been able to do by providing a logistics base in Djibouti and then other relationships that they will have in the Indian Ocean in particular, it makes it very easy for that force structure to be more effective, to be more routine. And so I think the question for us is, how do we then position ourselves to deal with this change in force structure? And as Japan looks toward more far-ranging operations and their interests in the Middle East and the competition that will take place in the Middle East and the relationships that are going to develop, particularly with India, what are the force structure implications? What are the capacity implications for that? And I think that's a discussion that we have to have, because capacity is going to matter. The flags of naval ships flying in various ports in that area of the world will be a symbol of diplomacy, of economic reach, and of security guarantees, and we have to think our way through that.
Yes, the question is, what is their intent to build a new facility or base, whatever you call, in Djibouti? Because it is true that they have been contributing positively to the operations counter-piracy in that area, but the actions they may take beyond the horizon of counter-piracy, that will dictate the further nature of their reasoning of being there and having the overseas resupply facilities. So that's my comment.
Yes, I'd like to say the from the other point. From Chinese point of view, its maritime policy has these several kinds of contents. The East China Sea and South China Sea, China wants to change the two seas to be an inner sea of China. However, India and the Pacific is not. It is different from the South China Sea and the East China Sea, I think. Maybe for a Chinese point of view, Indian Ocean is the so important for China, just on the economy or the sea lane or strategic, and Pacific also. So how do we respond to the Chinese policy? The one great big important point is that the Chinese intention. Chinese intention has several kinds of view. So we have to divide, we have to separate such a response to China. In South China Sea and East China Sea, we have to more express more strongly. However, Pacific and the Indian Ocean, we can cooperate with China or something. We get much more options. Thank you.
So it seems to me that China has legitimate interests in having presence in that part of the world, including their joint base at Djibouti, and you mentioned the counter-piracy operations, which are a contribution to international efforts. There are increasing pressures within China for the government to have the capability for non-combatant evacuation operations because they have workers all over the Middle East, and they're getting kidnapped, and they're, as we saw in Libya and elsewhere. And of course, there's sea lines of communication. So there's a list of things that it seems to me we should recognize or legitimate and appropriate. On the other hand, you know, I think the U.S. and Japan share an interest in the Indian Ocean as part of the Indo-Pacific. I don't think it's our responsibility to secure the Indian Ocean. I would argue that ultimately we want India to be a net exporter of security for that ocean. But we do have a definite interest in it for defense and depth and so forth. And if there's a more negative dimension to China's increasing capacity in that area, it would be the possibility, I would think, for horizontal escalation, for basically messing with the Indian Ocean, which we in Japan and others would have to care about, and stretch us out. But then one wonders, so, okay, is that the German fleet in the Pacific in 1914? Far away, undefended, poor lines of supply, and they just get rolled up by the Imperial Japanese Navy and the Australians? Or is it something that would actually be a strategic problem for us? So I want to throw it back at you one more time to think about, you know, the ledger sheet, you know, the malicious, potentially the benign, and what kind of capacity do we need or our allies need to make sure that it stays benign?
Well, I think the question for the United States and particularly for Japan as well, as you look at the Middle East, it really is about the energy resources that are there, guaranteeing those flows. Also, the nature of the security relationships that we have with countries in the Middle East, and the idea of a presence and an influence in that area, and the question becomes, is it the United States' interest, and what are the rule sets and the types of relationships that we want? What are the habitual relationships that we have that, when it comes time to deal with broader issues and deal with coalition forming and operations, what has been the shifts and where? Is there a sense of presence and commitment? And so I think that's what we're going to be dealing with. And as we have seen, forces get stretched. I couldn't agree more with you. India is going to be a huge player. India will want to be a player. As I've said on several occasions, they think that ocean is appropriately named, and they'll follow up on that. But the types of relationships that we have with India, the way that we work together, the way that we bring our capabilities in line with one another are going to be hugely important. And so decisions will be being made. Who is the dominant power in that area? And I think that leads me to my comments with respect to capacity. And you have to have the capacity to be there.
Thank you.
Yes, well, China has deployed multiple times the submarines to the Indian Ocean, given the reasoning of assisting the counter-piracy operation. And that is a very much different way of using the submarines from my Navy. And so this makes me pretty much confused what is their intention. So as I mentioned, well, physically, the joint and combined ISR, intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance is quite important to know what is being done in the theater and to speculate what is the real intention of anyone. Thank you.
Yeah, so I agree with Professor Otsuka's opinion. Yes, we have to grasp the Chinese intention itself at the Indian Ocean, like the Chinese policy towards Myanmar or Pakistan and other areas. So I'd like to get the much more multilateral framework, including US, Japan plus one, such a multilateral framework to respond to Chinese expansion in Indian Ocean and other areas. Thank you.
Sensei, that's a good segue to the next thing I wanted to explore a little bit, which is how we deal with this growing Chinese capacity and capability in the first island chain, the second island chain, the Indian Ocean, areas that, at least for the U.S., we haven't had to worry about since 1945 that much, with the exception of the Sea of Okhotsk and the Soviets, you know, in the late 70s and early 80s. Our defense budgets are not going to grow as much as China's. China's new announced defense budget increase, if you saw it today, is lower than usual, but it's a lot higher than ours. Australia is committed to 2%. You know, the new white paper of GDP, the Abbott commitment stays. We're struggling with Budget Control Act and sequestration. Prime Minister Abe's slightly upticked, and I think probably slightly favored the maritime services to deal with this. But the bottom line is, we're going to have to do more with the same, maybe even more with less. And jointness, interoperability, connectivity among alliances that have been very bilateral, or increasing interoperability jointness within bilateral alliance, Japan, US, for example, it seems to me all of that adds both capacity and capability. We've talked about this because Admiral Roughead was one of the important advisors to the external review we did for the Congress on the NDA, and we had a lot of discussions among former PACOM commanders and three MEF commanders and others about how to set up command and control relationships. The Admiral Kawano said, I saw that he's interested in setting up a joint operational command, something that we had looked at in our study. So I wanted to ask particularly you and Admiral Otsuka, you know, what is that, what ideally, there are domestic politics, there's the Chinese sensitivities, but ideally, What is a kind of networked capacity with like-minded states look like? Is it based on common platforms, interoperability? What kind of command relationships? There's a lot in there, but if you could give us a sense of what that ideally would look like, and then Umio as well, and Kawashima-san.
First off, I think there are going to be occasions where the U.S. and Japan and other countries are going to want to operate with the PLA in areas that are of mutual benefit. So this is not an either or choice. But that said, I think as we look at this broader area and we look at the maritime challenges that we're going to face and the locations where they're going to occur, what I tend to think of is more of a tiered system of cooperation. And among the United States and Japan, and I'll add in Australia, that we will bring in the more extensive capabilities and capacities to deal with maintaining an awareness of what's going on in these ocean areas. We will be able to have in place, because of the nature of our alliance structure, communication paths that others may not be able to deal with, intelligence sharing that others will not be part of that scheme. And so I think there's going to be a tier that will be established. And if you just look at the capabilities that we all operate, those alignments are already taking place. I think some of the high priority areas will be in what I would call maritime domain awareness. What are the, you know, the ability for us to invest in common systems and architectures that allow us to have long dwell, very good resolution of what's happening in the broader ocean areas, and then being able to home in and focus in on particular areas that are of interest. I think also we, as I alluded to in my remarks, the need for enhanced undersea domain awareness will be key. And so how do we bring ourselves together to do that? And I will say that I am very hopeful that Australia makes the decision as it recapitalizes its submarine fleet, that its selection turns toward Japan. Because I think from an operational and a strategic point of view, that could be very helpful in this undersea area. I do believe that the environments in which we'll operate will be very stressing in the air defense world. Fortunately, we all are investing in the similar air defense systems, and our interest in ballistic missile defense, while an irritant to China and Russia, is something that we should not back off on, because I think that will play heavily into warfare of the future. So those are just some areas that I think we're well positioned, but again, it will be important to do a tiered system and to be able to look at how we can plug in some of the less capable partners that we're going to have and do it in a way that builds out on this broader architecture that I think we're going to need in the broader region.
Yes, I'm pretty sure that all our naval officers and men are confident enough to work shoulder to shoulder, side by side with the United States Navy in case of contingencies if that happens tomorrow or today. And that is that we can do that because our leadership has always tried to put the priority, the interoperability to put as a priority, a very high, almost the highest priority. And when you talk about the interoperability, you can talk from twofolded. One is from the hardware side, the other side is a more soft power type of thing. The hardware, it's the submarines and destroyers and so forth. And interestingly speaking, these hardwares, we are not the same thing. While some the same, like an Aegis system or BMD systems or maritime patrol aircraft, we are completely interoperable from the hardware point of view, whereas the submarine, we have completely different paths in the last 6 or 7 decades. We only have conventional submarines, whereas the United States currently only have nuclear. So we have a different things, but then what matters is the soft side of interoperability. It's in strategy and tactics or even doctrines. We completely share all those very important things that we continuously discuss with the United States, Navy to Navy at least, the doctrines and what we call TTPs, tactics and procedures. So therefore, we are very much confident to work together and use the different things synergizing into a for one purpose. Thank you.
Yes, Japan Alliance in Australia, yes, has to enhance its capability, and they can add India and other countries. However, I'm afraid that the China utilize the economic power towards certain countries to observe or cut off such alliances or networks. So we can make the broader networks. However, China has its own policy of this such a network. We have to check such a Chinese policy. Thank you.
So my sense, others may in the room may agree, may disagree. My sense is that our navies and our militaries, especially US Japan, but also, of course, Australia and others, have understood this general issue we're discussing for some time. And a large part of the problem has been that our national command authorities have not, or put another way, the view in the Kante and the White House, Prime Minister's office in Australia, the Chongwade in Korea, the strategic view, the assumption about what's happening and about what is at stake has not been aligned. And so the doctrine, track, tricks, and procedures have been aligning pretty well. But this is a problem that won't be solved only by military assets. It's going to require trade and diplomacy and a lot more. And we've not been aligned until, you know, maybe the last year or so. And so in some sense, I think we are beginning this game, if you will. Because in Tokyo, Canberra, and Washington now, there's a lot less divergence strategically in describing at the highest levels what's happening. And I think just 2 years ago even, you would have had quite different interpretations in each capital. That'll go a long way towards making sure that there's support for the kind of procedures, integration you're talking about, but the other elements, which is going to include trade and architectural innovations and you know, economic agreements and so forth. So let me open it up to the audience, and we can take a broader cut on this if you'd like, and we'll start right here with our JIIA colleague. We have microphones, I believe? Yeah.
Thank you, Mike. I'm Yamagami from JIIA. In order to be fair, I have a question to each one of the three panelists. First, to Admiral Roughead, the role of US-Japan alliance. You said to the effect that you are more concerned about the situation in the East China Sea than South China Sea, because of capabilities of two nations involved. That said, you know, one observation would say that China is engaging in less of an adventurism in the East China Sea because of the presence of efficient Coast Guard along with robust naval forces on our part. Whereas in the South China Sea, the absence of these two, efficient Coast Guard and robust naval forces, are leading to rather blatant expansionism, not anymore creeping expansionism. So what role do you expect US-Japan alliance to play in the East China Sea, South China Sea? That's my first question. Second, to my good friend, Admiral Otsuka, the capability of your force, Japanese Maritime Self-Defense Forces. Much has been said about Chinese experience off the coast of Somalia, but Japan did play a role. So, and also, I understand your colleague, Admiral Ito, for the first time in history, he served as a commander of joint forces. So what kind of experience and expertise have you got from that? And how can you apply that to the exercise or operation in the South China Sea? And finally, to Professor Kawashima, if I heard you correctly, you said to the effect that the China changed strategy around year 2008, 2009. But there might be some observers who would say China's maritime strategy is much more, you know, long orchestrated. For example, even on Senkaku, they promulgated domestic law in 1992, and they started their incursion into territorial waters around Senkaku in year 2008, long before so-called nationalization by Japan. And if you turn your eyes to the South China Sea, as long as there is power vacuum, they came forward. So how would you see China's strategy? Thank you.
He's our co-sponsor, so he gets three questions. Don't the rest of you get any ideas?
So, with regard to the role in the East China Sea, I think one of the important dimensions of the backing off on adventurism, if I've heard your question, is really the strength of the alliance and the capabilities that are there. My concern about the East China Sea is that events, particularly in the air, could produce missteps and accidents that would very rapidly begin a potential escalation. So that's why I'm mainly concerned about that. But I think it's also important that as we look to the East China Sea and we look at the capabilities and interoperability between the two forces, you know, how do we move forward together? What are the compatible systems that we may want to have? As Mike alluded to, I really do believe, not just in the East China Sea, but more broadly, we really need to look at the command structures and command relationships. We in the U.S. really focus on our combatant command structures, but I really do think that we have to rethink, because of this broader maritime space, how do we put in place some more effective and efficient operational command structures? And as Japan looks at its changing operations and the distance and the types of things it will be doing, what are the command structures there? And how are we working together to make sure that we remain in step and that we actually enhance our ability to work more closely together? So those are some things there. With regard to the South China Sea, I think it's important that that the freedom of navigation continues to be demonstrated, and that we do it in a way that we don't forewarn, we simply do it as a matter of practice, that this is an area and a very, very important sea lane that we and others believe should be free for navigation. I think it's also important that we collectively put an all stop to all expansions and all enhancements in the South China Sea. You know, China is not the only one that seeks to do it. They have more resources and they can do it on a grander scale and put more capability there. I think that to go back to my comment about tiered capabilities, as we look at the South China Sea, how do we look at how we put the capabilities together? And as countries rush to assist and contribute and aid the militaries in that area, how are we doing it in a constructive and a coherent way, so that we're simply not throwing a bunch of stuff into the mix without the infrastructure and the means and the motivation to be able to maintain those capabilities? Because I think we could go around the world and in many areas where we have put a lot of stuff in there, and about 2 or 3 years on, they're wonderful pier ornaments and runway ornaments. And so how are we enhancing the ability for the countries to be able to maintain the capability and grow that capability?
Yeah, thank you very much for the question. First of all, the nature of operation is, it's pretty much constabulary. So having the Coast Guard officers on board our Navy destroyer gives us a great opportunity to learn about the difference between the pure military and constabulary business. So that's takeout number one. And second thing is the environment of operating in a multinational setting is a quite informative and educative for us. And we have been trained in like a RIMPAC in a multinational setting so far, and to include some others. We have been evolving our capability to work in a multinational setting, but this time Admiral Ito took the command of Task Force 151, gave us to know very deeply, and not only the knowledge, but the real ability, capability to how to use the multinational forces for one particular purpose. That's number two. And third is the operation in that area has given us a tremendous opportunity to engage with European navies, and the NATO and EU navies have contributed as well in that area. And it's quite productive for us that we recognize the similarity and also the difference to work with them. So those are the major takeout from those operations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's a good question. As I mentioned, China originally has a historical mission to recover its territory, lost territory. So China has wanted to recover the lost territories as possible as it can. So in 1940s, China set 11 dash line, ROC set 11 dash line, that PLC changed to 9 dash line in 1950s. And also in 1960s, 70s, China went to the Seychelles Island under the Vietnam War. Yes, so China got some opportunity to recover the island, right? So China itself, yes, there's some continuous policy to recover the island, that's right. However, in the Deng Xiaoping period after 1978, his foreign policy, the aim of foreign policy was just set on the economic development. So Deng Xiaoping and Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao, they could compromise something on the territorial issue with other countries, like the joint statement of South China Sea in 2002. Chinese PLC put aside the territorial issues at South China Sea. And also in 1990s, Jiang Zemin, he compromised so many to solve the territorial issues or border issues with the Central Asian countries. However, after 2008 or 2009, China changed the purpose of foreign policy so strongly. So Hu Jintao's latter period and Xi Jinping, they did not compromise about the territorial issue. So I said the change of the Chinese policy. Thank you.
Of course, 2008-9 is also when the Central Military Commission completed the Near Sea Doctrine, which Xi Jinping oversaw, and when you saw this spike in operations around and in the waters of the Senkaku. So that's a pretty, there's definitely, this builds over time for the reasons you said and the historical reasons, but there's a clear spike upwards in doctrine and in operational patterns around 2000, 2008, 2009, which also, of course, coincides with the financial crisis. There's a larger context for this. I think Admiral McDevitt, you're next. Up front here, thanks.
Thank you. I wanted to take advantage of your suggestion that we broaden the scope just a little. And when we talk about maritime security and the alliance, if we think about the East China Sea and the South China Sea as emblematic of a Chinese approach to international law in the sense that national interest trumps international law. And so if national interest in China's behalf coincide with international law, great. If they don't, national interest will trump it. And we've seen that also in the whole range of other international norms, human rights, the WTO, intellectual property, et cetera. So the point is, if this is foreshadowing how China will act or continue to act once the China dream is realized or whenever China is fully risen, whatever it is, this is not an aberration. This is a new normal potentially. So the question is, what should the alliance be doing about this?
Yeah, this is a big question. Yeah, that's right. China is now does not challenge all of norms in the world, maybe. Yeah, yeah. However, China wants to change the regional governance or regional norm at East Asia or Central Asia. This is a big point for Japan, the US-Japan alliance. So at first, we can cooperate with China on the global context. However, we have to be sensitive to Chinese new order in East Asia or Eurasia, I think. So, but if we against all of new norms or architecture made by China, it's not good for us, I think. So like AIB and other new architecture by China, yes, if we have chance, we can join it. We access the Chinese new norms to make some dialogue with China. It is efficient for us, I think. That's my answer.
Great question, Mike. Thank you. you know, I first off, I would say that you know, that's another case for having a security presence in areas that clearly are strategically along the two thrusts that China has been very clear about proceeding. I think Mike made a comment about how things have changed in the last couple of years, and I think it gets right to the heart of your question, in that, in my view, began when business started to see the changes that were taking place in China that ran counter to their interests. And so the term I use is that's when business started to begin to fall out of love in this movie that I'm talking about. And so I think the changes that we're seeing in business practices, intellectual property, information technology, you know, I really believe that we are not discussing enough about the changes that they would like to see in the NGO world. And NGOs are not just a bunch of humanitarian NGOs. It gets to our university system. It gets to our think tanks. It gets, quite frankly, to those who have been advocating for closer relationships with China over the last couple of decades. And so I think it's important that we continue to highlight, that we continue to call out the importance of adhering to the accepted norms. I think, and we haven't, you know, used this word yet, but TTP is going to be hugely important because that is the rule set that we would like to see play out in the region. And, you know, Ash Carter made the comment it was equal to one aircraft carrier. I think that was a low ball. You know, it really is the trump card, bad choice of words to play, on how we really need to think our way through this economic and security relationship. And then as we get into the maritime domain, you know, our lack of being party to the Convention on the Law of the Sea is not helpful. And so those are just a couple of areas that that come to mind in response to your question.
Well, just touch upon the naval issue. Admiral McDevitt is one of my mentors in the Navy, so not responding to you, but in general speaking, the Navy usually, when we talk about the naval strategy, we use a mission triangle, which is Navy has a three type of roles. One is military, one is constabulary, and the other one is diplomacy. And the diplomacy during the peacetime is represented by the action of so-called presence. So wherever you provide the naval presence, that indicates your appetite to want to be engaged with that area. And PLA Navy was not a global navy before until, well, I should say the mid-2000s, but as soon as they started the deployment for counter-piracy, they have maximized the opportunity to provide a naval presence visiting as many ports as possible on the way to or on the way back from there. And in addition, they deployed like hospital ships to the African coast, or even to the Caribbean. And I think this is one of their intent to want to be globally engaged. So therefore, again, for what purpose? Is it peaceful or some others? Well, we have to be watch very carefully what's their true intent.
Noble?
Thank you, Nobu Akiyama, Hitotsubashi University. I appreciate a wonderful panel. My question actually goes to the two panelists, the two admirals from Japan and the United States. This is about the South China Sea question. China would be able to establish kind of anti-access or area denial capability there, then if our sort of ISR against the submarine would be very much restricted, then do you think that it would affect the calculation on the deterrence, in particular the nuclear capabilities? In particular, the Jin-class submarine acquire the quietness, then they are able to acquire the longer range SLBM, then how would you see the changes of this, survivability of the Chinese nuclear capabilities, and eventually would it affect our sort of strategic calculations?
Yeah, well, that's one of the reasons why I think it's important that we begin to think about the underwater domain and maintaining dominance there, and what's the way that we do that. And I think that particularly the United States and Japan have the potential and the opportunity to really do some collaboration and cooperation, not just in the operational sense, but in the technical sense. And how can we enter into arrangements where we can take advantage of the innovation that is so significant in both of our countries? And in my view, given the quieting that's taking place, we have to think very differently about the types of sensors and indeed about the types of vehicles that we're going to be using. I, for one, while I'm a huge proponent of unmanned aviation, we have not yet begun to scratch the surface of unmanned underwater systems. And that is going to be a bigger game changer in my mind than unmanned aerial systems. And that is an area where I think our innovation, where our research and development, where our technology can come together in very positive ways. Now, what this will also mean is that we have to look at how we move the cooperation, collaboration, and the technical process through what are two very different acquisition systems. And that's why I think that when we begin to talk more about how can the two countries cooperate, it can't simply be people in uniform talking to one another. I really do think that we have to bring our industry together, we have to bring our research and development communities together, and we have to bring our defense acquisition systems together. And I'm not saying that it has to model the U.S. because Lord knows we've got enough that we've got to clean up here. So I think that is an objective of how we should be thinking about moving our relationship forward in a significant way that really cuts into many dimensions of our technological and innovative capital that we both enjoy in ways that I would submit other countries don't share.
We have a project at CSIS we've been working on about a year, John, Federated Defense, which the Asia program I run in the Middle East and our defense international security program does collaboratively. And you can find the first series of studies online were about the requirements and opportunities for doing this through PACOM in the Asia Pacific region, doing exactly what you said. And then we looked at the Middle East, and then the last part is what would the U.S. have to do to revise, reform its acquisition process, technology process, and we're kind of stuck. That's a huge Gordian knot. But if there's a prioritization on this, there's industry interest, there's service interest. I mean, you could make it happen. We just have to have a new way of doing business, I think.
Right, and I would submit, if I may, that going at it through the COCOM lens is not the way to do it. You really have to get that broad industry R&D process cranking.
Yes, thank you for the question. Whether the China is able to make South China Sea as a bastion, it's an ongoing question, because the bastion strategy we had as an example during the Cold War is in Sea of Okhotsk. The undersea operation heavily depends on the difference of the nature of the area. And so, well, I have no idea yet whether the China can make South China Sea as a bastion. One reason being is that there are several countries already have and want to have submarines, the countries surrounding the South China Sea. So the situations underwater is becoming more and more complex. And I'm not sure whether that type of area can be successfully used as a bastion. This is a big question. And in addition, for deterrence, deterrence does not function as one-on-one basis. Perhaps each side may mobilize as many options as possible to deter the adversaries. So therefore, some kind of a comprehensive approach may compensate the lack of a capability and capacity of one side. Thank you.
John? John Hemmings, doctoral candidate at LSE and adjunct fellow here. To what extent is an ADIZ being proclaimed by China in the South China Sea a red line? How do we react to it diplomatically, strategically? And what's the kind of deeper significance of these ADIZs for China's overall strategy? Are they symbolic? Are they inflammatory? Or do they have a strategic risk that we need to really be careful about?
Yeah. It is also a difficult question. At first, China itself want to make East South China Sea to change to be an inner sea of China. So what is the red line? How do we respond to such a Chinese policy is so sensitive at first. Secondly, Chinese perception of U.S.'s policy, like free navigation, something, because the operation of free navigation was just set on the free navigation, so under the international law, context of international law, so China does not feel such a strong pressure from USA. So China did not change the policy. So if the deadline line or the most sensitive line was set on the free navigation itself, China can be accept free navigation. However, maybe the interpretation of free navigation is different between China and the USA and Japan, this first. Secondly, if we want to change policy, not to build the military facilities on the islands, it's so difficult. Yeah, to give the efficient pressure toward China. If all USA and Japan wants to change China policy, we have to adopt a much more stronger or efficient policy toward China. But the operation of free navigation cannot change it. Yes, I think. Yeah, because the Chinese perception is different from us. Yeah. Thank you.
I think as I see it, the importance of the periphery to China can't be overstated, whether it's maritime or terrestrial, and how China prioritizes the integrity and the security of the periphery, I think, is hugely important. And the historic context is also significant because of the legitimacy and the wrongs that they have had to endure as a result of having lost this historic claim. And then, of course, there's no question that the economic dimension is significant, whether it's the sea lanes, whether it's the potential for energy, or even the food sources that will be important and will be diminishing in the years ahead. And then there's the security dimension and being able to keep at distance those capabilities that threaten them. With regard to freedom of navigation, there is no question that there are two very different views as to what is allowed and what is not allowed. And statements of not infringing on freedom of navigation can either be accepted, but depending on your rule set of what it is it's unacceptable. And as we've seen over the years, our interpretations are different. And we believe that they're based in law. And I believe, therefore, it's important that we continue to exercise that freedom of navigation as we define it.
I want to jump in briefly on that. I would not be surprised if either immediately before or after the tribunal's decision on the Philippine case, Beijing announced an ADIZ or even an ADIZ over the South China Sea, you know, exactly over the Nansha district, over the nine dash line. Unlike the ADIZ announcement in the East China Sea, they'll have, with this new spider web of island outposts, the ability to enforce, at least against anyone other than us and maybe Japan, that ADIZ. They'll be able to put fighters up. They'll have more presence than they had with the East China Sea ADIZ announcement. So it would be very intimidating. I do not think we will have a successful strategy if our strategy is to get them to take it back, because they won't. I think we ignore it. We demonstrate how much we ignore it. As the Admiral said, freedom of navigation operations, I do a lot of these. I do them regularly. I wouldn't sweat about it. I just do it. I think other countries should do it. Australia, Japan, Korea, India. Maybe we can get a British frigate for a couple months and use it. I mean, it would be an outrageous act, a defiance of international law, because it would be in response, if my scenario happens, to the tribunal decision, and use it to get more international support for the tribunal, for rule of law, and more integration of strategies and operations in the region. But rolling it back I don't think that's possible. And we also have to recognize that airlines, if I were a lawyer for a major airline in Asia, I'd say file your flight plans. They have no choice. They have to kind of take care of the liability risk and all the rest. So it would be leaky, but it would be a big deal. And I, as I said, I wouldn't be surprised to see that. We know Beijing's not going to accept what most people expect will be a favorable ruling for Manila. So it's a good question. We may be facing this sometime in the spring. Now, let me see. I had Paul next.
Thank you, Mike. Paul Giar, Global Strategies and Transformation. My sense is that the maritime democracies in the Indo-Pacific are in real trouble, that at 2% defense growth nominally, that's an average between 1 and 3 or so, we're just not getting there, that the establishment of a Chinese base at the Gulf of Aden, which is the throat to the Mediterranean and the going traffic going both ways has passed relatively unremarked, and that we are never going to have the force structure and capacity that we need. My hypothesis is that there are numbers of ways. One is better technology, one is good doctrine, and so on. But another way is intelligence sharing and fusion and common operational picture. But that and Mike sort of touched on this. We have just started that, even in the U.S.-Japan alliance, where we've interoperated, but we haven't integrated in that sense. and we certainly haven't synchronized. What are the, in the context of the Five Eyes defense intelligence sharing arrangements, which is sort of the gold standard, if I can say it that way, in that context, what do you think the objective should be in the U.S.-Japan alliance, just to simplify it, and what are the obstacles to getting there?
One is, I think, that that particularly as we look at how we currently operate with Japan, the types of systems that we have in common and will have in the future, whether it's airborne early warning, the Global Hawk Triton family of systems, I think will be huge. And we do, as you know, share information among one another. So I think how we evolve the nature of the architectures and then working our way through the sharing agreements with Japan, I think takes us into this higher tiered level that I referred to a couple times. And I think that we have all the potential to do that going forward. And then folding in Australia, I think is very easily done. And each country is going to have to deal with its national interests and concerns and politics. But I think that we have the pieces in place to really advance this very, very quickly. You know, we've mentioned India and how we work with them. I know, and I'm a huge advocate of bringing our military-to-military relationship closer. But I think as you're seeing play out recently, we seem to be getting closer again to information sharing agreements, logistics agreements. We've seen this movie before, so we'll see how quickly that moves. But I think we really need to start thinking now about how we integrate India into this bigger Indian Ocean picture, because it's going to be a challenge. India will still want to remain non-aligned. India will still source a lot of its military equipment from countries that will be problematic. So, you know, do we want to plug an Aegis or a E-2D into a network that has MiGs flying around in it? You know, I'm not sure we're there yet. So that adds to the problem. But I think with regard to Japan and Australia and others, it is there. We just have to get our work our way through some of the bureaucracy. But I think all the great potential to work together very, very closely as an alliance.
You mentioned Five Eyes. British military and intelligence sharing with the U.S. began exactly 100 years ago, almost to the month, which was when Colonel House, Woodrow Wilson's advisor, started getting regular briefings from the British military intelligence representative in Washington. That's a long, long history of working together with the Commonwealth countries folding in. So, you know, I think this culturally and in terms of strategic bureaucratic culture will take some time. In Japan's case, it's complicated by political oversight. How does the Diet provide oversight to intelligence? Will Japan create intelligence committees like we have or the Commonwealth countries? That's a big, big challenge. I'm trying to picture the fifth-term member of the LDP who's on the Intelligence Oversight Committee, and the head of his faction over sake says, "So what did they tell you today?" I mean, it's going to take you said bureaucratic. It's political too, and political cultural. But it's I agree with the admiral. It's we got to do it, and it may be peace. It may be ASW. It may be specific things, imagery. It may be one piece at a time. But it's got to be. I think the premise of your question is right. It's got to be a priority going forward. Let's see, Chip, up front.
Chip Gregson, Avicen International and Center for the National Interest. Great session. Thank you. I'd like to take advantage of Admiral Roughhead's movie metaphor to describe the part of the movie that I'm seeing that I think is significant. Since about 2010, the Chinese have radically amped up the stakes in the South China Sea. It went from denying that they declared it a core interest to declaring it a core interest to now we have the oft-repeated, at very high levels, undisputed historical sovereignty. This seems to me to raise this to the level of a survival interest for the Chinese regime. Xi Jinping cannot back off of this except at great risk for his continued leadership. So this then raises the question, what happens next? What do we do next? Given undisputed historical sovereignty and President Xi's recent visit to the media to encourage them to keep ramping up this nationalist rhetoric, I think we have to face the fact that we may not only not walk this back in the South China Sea, may not be able to stop it. So then the question is, how do we react to maintain the confidence of our allies and friends? At the high end with Japan and Australia, we talked interoperability. There's a lot of work to do, but I think that that's farther along. With like Vietnam and the Philippines, as Admiral Roughead questioned in one of his comments, how do we get them into the fight? I think there's a couple things necessary. One, on a policy level, we have to be absolutely clear with China that their continued actions in the South China Sea and elsewhere leave us no choice but to enhance our alliance capabilities, regardless of whether they find that destabilizing or not. As a way of working with the Philippines and Vietnam, Japan is already working with our two friends. They're, besides providing some military articles, they're pumping some loans into there to help with littoral area infrastructure, which is terrific. It can be dual use. We need to move forward quickly on what former Secretary Gates termed a widely distributed, politically sustainable, operationally resilient presence by deploying small training elements with Vietnam and the Philippines that have all the right comm gear and all the right weapons that can reach out the sea and reach out in the air, if it comes to that, to join in the maritime fight. We need to be able to demonstrate the robust deterrence to China to stop this continued advance at some point. And I'd like comments from any of the panel members that care to talk about it.
Well, again, General Gregson is far senior than myself, so it's not the position to tell him something. But my impression is the 101 of the military operation is to obtain the situational awareness. And for that purpose, from that viewpoint, the level of the capability of those local countries are far less than China compared with China in terms of that type of capability of ISR. And therefore, that's why I believe the capacity building is very fundamental. Well, I don't say an objective of allies, but perhaps it's the good option for allies or partner countries to level up that situational awareness posture.
Cooney, in the back over here. Oh, did you want to comment on this? Okay, why don't you comment? One moment, please. Sorry about that.
First off, I'm not going to use the term, how do we get them into the fight, Chip? Because I think the objective really is, how do we create a scheme, an architecture, a solidarity among the countries for, what we would consider the legal and responsible use of the sea lanes and the areas around them. I also think it is important that, one of the things that always bothered me a little bit was how much we spent on capacity building without really having a measurement at the end of, what is going on. And so the training is good, but I really do think how we can integrate awareness systems, how we can elevate the competence and the readiness and the efficiency of some of the smaller forces that are going to be working in their coastal areas and in their, near sea areas, in the places that are economically important, and collectively insisting on the accepted rule set for legal and responsible behavior. So, that's where we have to go. And I think, capabilities and capacity are going to be hugely important. And it just can't be a level of activity.
Thank you. Kuni Miyake, I'm based in Tokyo. I like to change the perspective a little bit because Admiral Roughead referred to the possible potential evolution of Iranian Navy in the future. And this is, to me, it's pretty ominous because if it's not, I'm not talking about the weeks or years, probably. It could be in decades, but still, I'm worried about the Iranian naval expansion. And my specific question is this, because, of course, it's just hypothetical, but if the A2AD capability is not confined to China, it's also with the Iranians. If the Iranian naval capability expands, then is it the responsibility of the Fifth Fleet to deal with it, or do we need additional support from the Seventh Fleet, which might undermine a future operational capability of the Seventh Fleet, which covers not only the Indian Ocean, but the Western Pacific. So if that's the case, I hope it's not going to happen, but if that's the case, what will be the role of the Japanese self-defense forces, especially maritime self-defense forces?
Well, thank you for the question. And from the standpoint of the responsibility, it will be the Fifth Fleet's responsibility to deal with that geographic area. But the reason that I mentioned it really was to begin to start to think through how countries and navies that have vested interests in the Middle East and the energy flows and the trade flows are going to have to deal with another navy that is going to rise. There's no question in my mind that the Iranian Navy will enhance its capability, will enhance its numbers as the means flow in. Now, how it will then interact with the Revolutionary Guard will be very interesting, because I think a lot of the internal politics will come into play. But you know, the Iranian Navy used to be fairly significant. In fact, those of us who wear the U.S. Navy uniform, you know, we ended up buying 4 ships that the Iranians were going to buy, and they were far more capable than the ships that we were buying at the time. So, and I'm talking about the 4 kid-class destroyers that we had. So, I think we have to start thinking about it. We have to start considering what the force structure will be there. We have to begin to think about how that new capability will change the equation in the Straits of Hormuz and in the Red Sea, because I think that they will want to be able to operate on both sides of the kingdom. And so this is going to change the calculus, and that has to be part of the force structure. But as far as will 7th Fleet have to begin to have more of a responsibility? This is going to be a 5th Fleet responsibility, but how the forces flow, I think, will be important. And I would even go so far as to say that it will begin to affect the Eastern Mediterranean, because we have what I consider to be the resurgent empires at play again. Ottoman Empire in the form of Turkey, the Persian Empire, because of its involvement in the Levant, China, because of it coming up, and of course the Russian Empire, because now it has access coming out of the Black Sea. So, you know, you can take the movie and you can play it even more broadly, but Iran is going to change, its maritime capability will change, and we need to be thinking about that.
Andrew Horos, where did you go? There, over here on the side.
Thanks very much, Mike. I'm Andrew Rose from Washington College. So it seems that one of the takeaways from a U.S. perspective in looking at maritime security in Asia is a very positive story of Japan streamlining its security practices, modestly increasing defense spending. We have our new U.S.-Japan guidelines for defense cooperation. So there's a lot to celebrate in this seminar this year. So I don't want to throw a downer on the party, but I'd like to throw out sort of a different perspective, which is thinking about Japan's relative decline, its actual population decline now, I made a note here. Even looking at defense spending, if you look at the decreased value of the yen, in comparative terms, Japan's defense spending is going down still. So I'm wondering, looking out sort of 10 to 20 years, with the differential growth rates of the U.S. and Japan that are likely to continue, I mean, right now the Japanese economy is about a quarter of the size of the U.S. economy compared to over 50% the size of the U.S. economy a couple decades ago. So if those trend lines continue, what does that mean for the alliance, you know, as we're planning 10 to 20 years out? So how can we make sure that Japan still gets the attention of top U.S. policymakers? And it seems that one approach is to find new partners, and many of you have mentioned Australia and India and other places, but can these new partners really offset what Japan has contributed to the U.S.-Japan alliance in the last 30 years at the end of the Cold War and at the beginning of the post-Cold War period?
I'm going to take a first stab and let my colleagues think. You know, demographics are undeniable, but not predictive. That's what any demographer will tell you. Societies adapt, and so forth. I think what the implications of this are that we have to be much, much smarter. This goes for the U.S. for different reasons other than demographics. So, for example, the way we do host nation support is not cost effective. It's based on a system designed to buy socialist party support through base workers. There are more efficient ways to do host nation support. The way we develop weapons, in indigenous systems in Japan, building U.S. systems and then charging a huge amount of money to retool them so they can be sold to Japan, we're not going to be able to afford to do that anymore. The obstacles to effective operations, like the ban on collective self-defense. So, you know, my back of the envelope calculation is we probably have a lot more in the alliance to gain from smarter policies and reforms than we'll lose from the trajectories you're describing. And then, of course, networking does matter. The Japan-Australia, Japan-India relationships, Japan-Philippines, those, you know, external balancing for fellow political scientists, that is a form of deterrence too. But the bottom line is, you're right, Andrew, and we just can't afford to be kind of complacent about this and do the way we did in this alliance.
No, I think Mike and I will be on the same sheet. I think we have to go forward recognizing what the pressures will be and what the realities will be, not simply pressing the button that says we're going to solve everything with cyber and unmanned capability, which I think there's a tendency to do. And one of the things that I think we need to think through, especially as we go into the unmanned world, is that there's no such thing. There's a human being in some form or function in that unmanned system. So how do we design it, and how do we enter the argument with the fact that, you know, the objective is really to bring manpower down totally in building these systems? I think it will also be important that we recognize the challenge in how we construct our command relationships. And in designing headquarters that are efficient and lean in ways that allow for both countries to not be strapped in the human capital area. Because once you start getting into the high end of warfare and operational headquarters, you're really talking about people who are experienced and skilled and knowledgeable, and it's great to put up a manning document with all these positions on it, but you also have to look at how are you going to fill it, how much will it cost, and what's the propensity to serve. And I think as long as you enter into the discussions between particularly Japan and the U.S. and other like-minded countries, that you have to be talking in these terms and be able to lay out executable and realistic plans that take into account the demographic realities.
Yes. It is true that we have been the manning problem has always been existing, and this is a balance between the needs and the cost and the asset or resource, and the resource allocation has always been the problem for the military issues all over the world, I believe. But in case of Japan, we have been joint for the last 10 years, and that created some efficiency, of course, together with effectiveness. And maybe that declining demography will change our mindset of the manning concept to reduce drastically, or change the allocation policy of the people. And how we can contribute, given the limited resource to this alliance, is we have, you'd better have another aspect of like our geographic, geostrategic advantage plus our quality of our contribution, like we have hosted the United States forces in Japan in the last seven decades. And well, this is, I'm not American, but what I always hear from my counterpart is the quality of the maintenance in Yokosuka Naval Facility, the U.S. facility. And we have hosted a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier, and that which sustains a U.S. forward presence, permanent forward presence. And so, therefore, all those comprehensive issues must be taken into account to discuss the alliance contribution. Thank you.
Yes, so U.S.-Japan alliance will getting to be much more matured and stable, I think. But from a Chinese point of view, the a local country in East Asia has a strong dilemma on this point that you mentioned. On the economic power, as China is a strong economic power in East Asia, Japan cannot play a role such as China now. So China, China utilize the economic power to influence on the local countries some military or much more sensitive part. For example, China utilized the economic investment, huge economic investment, to build the ports as the maritime area, like in Southeast Asia. Yes, this is the port is set on the gray zone between economy and military. So some Malaysia and Singapore, has a big project with China to build ports. However, they are all hesitant. They can accept this investment or not. So we have to, that's right. Our alliance is mature, but we have to have to be much more sensitive on such issues.
When I was a graduate student at CSIS, back during the Cold War, Marshall Green, who was Assistant Secretary of State, Ambassador to Australia, one of the great Japan and alliance hands in State Department history, and he was getting on in years, took me out to coffee to give me career advice, and he said, over the next 30, 40 years, the most important challenge you will face in Asia is overpopulation. And you need to dedicate your career to getting the birth rate down in Japan and Korea and China. I thought about it for a while, but I wasn't sure how I could personally do it. Yoichi Kato.
My name is Yoichi Kato with Rebuild Japan Initiative Foundation. It seems to me what been talked about what China is doing in South China Sea can be summed up that they are trying to advance their strategic interests and also expand their sphere of influence through low intensity ways and means. I think we have to admit that the United States, and also Japan, for that matter, has been fairly powerless to deter such efforts and stop their activities. And should I stop?
They're mocking you.
First of all, including what Secretary of Defense Ashton Carter said at the Shangri-La Dialogue last year, he said in the face of the Chinese delegations to halt the land reclamation, but the China didn't totally ignore it to this day. So this declaratory policy is not working, and then United States conducted a FONOP freedom of navigation operation in South China Sea, starting last fall. But it's not. It's this show of force operation is not working, and I think the other tool that Japan, United States and Japan is putting into practice is perhaps the capability building, capacity building of the regional states to indirectly stop this kind of effort by China, but that's not working either. So it seems to me we don't have tools to really deal with this low intensity approach of China. So my question is, what is it that we can do or United States can do to really deal with this kind of approach by China to advance their strategic interests? And if we don't have any realistic and effective tools, what do we do? Do we just give up on stopping or deterring that kind of low intensity approach and just focus on deterring the high-end conflict? Thank you.
We'll end with this. So, Admiral, please, and this is your chance to, it's a good last question, yeah. So it's a good chance to wrap up.
Yeah, I think it will be important as we look at what's happening to weigh the phrase that you used, is not working. Has China stopped its expansion? Probably not. But I think one of the things that's happened as we have come on in a more firm way with freedom of navigation operations and the public statements is that what we're beginning to see, or at least what I'm beginning to see as someone from now on the outside looking in, is changing attitudes with regard to how we deal with China, changing interests on the part of countries in the region that perhaps are putting a bit more wary eye on it. And so I think what I'm seeing is a change in attitude and perhaps a bit more resolve in ensuring that that our freedoms in that area are not infringed upon. So, as I said, this is a long movie that we're going to be watching. And to simply say it's not working because we've had another missile emplacement, I think we need to take the longer view. We have to make sure that we're working cooperatively, collectively, and working with other countries in the region to ensure that the rule set that we believe should be in play prevails in the long term.
Well, Mr. Kato asked the question how the United States is going to should do, but I'm not American.
I think you said no. We.
Well, it's a million-dollar question, and I have just established Institute for Future Warfare Studies, IFUS, so that's a good homework to my institute. So that's my answer.
Yes, I can answer. Yes, what can we do? Yes. I think the Chinese side also feels some pressure from us, yes. And not so efficient, but China feels the pressure, yes. So I think at first, it is important to grasp Chinese perception of our policy and operation. About the concept of cost or composition, if China does not share the feeling of cost, this is cannot be efficient. Yes, this is the first point, yes. And also, in order to grasp its perception, we have to expand the opportunity to dialogue among US, Japan, and PLC, and other actors, including Taiwan, I think. And also, we have to keep the original policy toward China. On the diplomatic phase, we can share the recognition of South China Sea and the importance of rule of law on sea, Z7, ASEAN, and other countries to give pressure to China. It's also efficient, yes. Yeah, but it has limited. Secondly, we can support the capability of maritime security, yes, as we discussed. And Japan can enhance the presence of self-defense, USA also, in South China Sea to make joint exercise with USA, Australia, and other countries in Southeast Asia and the local areas, yes, at South China Sea and other areas. And Japan fleet to go and come to from India and Washington can arrive some ports at South China Sea and so on. And so it is important for us to imagine the Chinese perception, what is efficient. Yes, maybe we have many tools and ways, yeah, to access the Chinese feeling. Yes, it's not enough only now, I think. I believe it. Thank you.
So what do? We have more seminars, because I'm being facetious. But this problem is not going to be solved or go away. As I said at the beginning, my sense is we know the tools pretty well, but our strategic assumptions have not really aligned until recently among like-minded maritime states. I think, in my own personal experience, when I go to the Hill, when I go to Canberra, when I go to Tokyo, I hear much more consistency in this Massachusetts Avenue think tank concentration too. I hear much more consistency across the aisle about what we're up against, what we're dealing with. And that's, you know, that's the beginning of tying all of these instruments together in a strategy. But it's going to be a long-term thing. We're not talking about the Korean Peninsula today, but to me it was quite interesting that when the U.S. drafted a Security Council resolution after the nuclear and missile tests, Beijing sat on it for 6 or 7 weeks. And then when the Republic of Korea said, we're closing Kaesong and we want THAAD batteries, boom, there was movement. And I think Beijing has interests. They're understandable in many respects. China will calculate its interests will decide when it's pushed too hard and when it's starting to put at risk larger interests. And that will not be decided in one freedom of navigation operation. It won't even be decided if TPP passes. It's going to be a constant process. And as someone, one of the panelists put it very well, a process where we're enhancing deterrence, but simultaneously putting in place ways to avoid escalation. It's a two-part game. So let me conclude by thanking Nogami-san, our colleagues at JIIA, Kotani-san and staff, and Nick Sancheni and everyone at CSIS, and all of you for coming. We have a reception back there with some food and drink. I think it's Japanese Navy curry rice and rum, but in the maritime theme. I'm not sure what it is, but hope you can join us to continue the conversation. But first, let's thank Admiral Roughead, Admiral Otsuka, and Professor Kawashima.